From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
So is it the most gravest moment in my life? Yes, but also in all of human history. And things like the election will have an impact on this.
With the U.S. midterm elections a day away, we turn to the world-renowned linguist and dissident Noam Chomsky to talk about the elections, the possibility of a new nuclear arms race, and climate change.
The Republican Party is simply a major threat to not only to the country, but to human survival. I've said in the past that I think they're the most dangerous organization in human history on the issue of climate change alone.
But first we go to Florida, where a far-right extremist and self-proclaimed misogynist shot dead two women at a yoga studio in Tallahassee, Florida, on Friday, and critically wounded others. We'll speak with Soraya Chamale about the male supremacy movement. She's author of Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger.
The core of so many of these ideologies, whether you're talking about what are known as incels, which are involuntary celibates, or, racist, neo-Nazi white supremacist groups, one of the fundamental ordinal forms of dividing people and controlling people is gender. It is the first order of dividing and controlling people.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Trump administration's reimposed harsh economic sanctions against Iran, drawing condemnation from European allies and massive protests across Iran. The new sanctions officially began at 12:01 this morning, 6 months after President Trump withdrew the U.S. from the 2015 nuclear agreement that saw Iran win sanctions relief in return for abandoning much of its nuclear program. France, Germany, Britain and the European Union issued a joint statement Friday condemning the U.S. move, calling the Iran deal essential for the security of Europe, the region and the whole world. But European and Asian companies have largely cut back purchases of Iranian oil for fear of reprisals from Washington. The sanctions came just after Iranians celebrated the 39th anniversary of the Islamic Revolution. This is Iran's Supreme Leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei.
The U.S. is much weaker today than it was 40 years ago when the revolution was victorious. The power of the U.S. is on the decline. This is the important point. Most of the world's politicians and global affairs analysts believe that the U.S.'s soft power is worn out. It's being destroyed.
On Friday, President Trump tweeted a photo of himself with the words, "Sanctions are coming November 5th. Written over his image. The words written in the font of the popular HBO program Game of Thrones. In a statement, HBO said, quote, "It would prefer our trademark not be misappropriated for political purposes." In Florida, a far-right extremist and self-proclaimed misogynist shot and killed two women at a Tallahassee yoga studio Friday afternoon, injuring five others before turning the gun on himself. 40-year-old Scott Beerley had a long criminal history of attacking women, black people and immigrants via online videos and songs, and had previously been investigated for harassing women and arrested at least twice, once on allegations of battery against women. The victims of Friday's shooting were both from Florida State University, 21-year-old Maura Binkley and 61-year-old medical doctor and Florida State University faculty member Nancy Van Nessem. Maura Binkley traveled to Washington, D.C. in the wake of the Parkland massacre in February to lobby lawmakers with Parkland survivors and their families. We'll have more on the Florida shooting after headlines. In election news, Georgia's Secretary of State and Republican gubernatorial candidate Brian Kemp announced plans Sunday to investigate Georgia's Democratic Party for cyber crimes related to an alleged attempted hack of the voter registration system. Kemp's office provided no evidence for the claim, which has been denied by the Georgia Democratic Party. This came just 2 days before the midterm elections, when Kemp will face off against Democratic challenger Stacey Abrams, who could become the country's first African-American woman governor if she wins. On Friday, a federal judge barred Georgia from rejecting ballots that don't conform to the strict exact match rules, where even a minor discrepancy in a voter's ID and their voter registration could prevent someone from voting. The rejections would have disproportionately affected African-American voters. Kemp was holding back more than 50,000 voter forms. Many have called on him to recuse himself as Secretary of State while he runs for governor of Georgia, since the Secretary of State oversees the elections. Meanwhile, President Trump and former President Barack Obama hit the campaign trail throughout the weekend, making a last-minute appeal to voters, speaking at a campaign rally for Indiana Democratic Senator Joe Donnelly in Gary on Sunday. Obama took aim at Trump's lies and distortions.
Because, unlike some people, I don't just make stuff up when I'm talking. I've got facts to back me up. I believe in fact-based campaign. I believe in reality-based governance.
Joe Donnelly is one of the Democrats fighting to retain his seat in the U.S. Senate, along with North Dakota's Heidi Heitkamp, Florida's Bill Nelson, and Missouri's Claire McCaskill, New Jersey's Bob Menendez, and Joe Manchin of West Virginia, all Democrats. Meanwhile, reports show Kansas Secretary of State and Republican gubernatorial candidate Kris Kobach has received donations from white nationalists and has had ties with far-right groups for at least a decade. Kobach is in a tight race against Democratic opponent Laura Kelly in what's considered a reliably red state. As Kansas Secretary of State, Kobach has come under fire after the sole polling place for Dodge City was moved outside of the town, disproportionately affecting Latino voters, not near public transportation. As candidates made their closing arguments, President Trump continued to rail against a caravan of Central American migrants crossing Mexico in order to seek political asylum in the United States. On Friday, the first of thousands of active-duty U.S. soldiers arrived at the U.S.-Mexico border in Texas, where they installed coils of razor wire on a riverbank and bridge. This is President Trump speaking at a campaign rally in Montana Saturday.
We have our military now on the border. And I noticed all that beautiful barbed wire going up today. It was a barbed wire used properly can be a beautiful sight.
CNN reports Pentagon leaders rebuffed an order by Trump to have the military act as law enforcement on the U.S.-Mexico border. Such a move would violate the Posse Comitatus Act, which bars soldiers from taking on a domestic police role. Meanwhile, NBC is under fire for airing a racist political ad paid for by President Donald Trump's campaign during its broadcast of Sunday Night Football. The ad features a Mexican man, Luis Bracamontes, who was convicted of killing two California deputies earlier this year. In the ad, he's seen smiling and saying, "I'm going to kill more cops soon." The ad blames Democratic Party immigration policies for the killings. But the Sacramento Bee reports Bracamontes was deported during the Clinton administration, later returned to the U.S. during the George W. Bush administration. In the late 90s, Bracamontes was arrested on drug charges in Phoenix, Arizona, but later released for unknown reasons under anti-immigrant Sheriff Joe Arpaio. Nigeria's military has pointed to Donald Trump's words to justify its deadly shootings of protesters last week in the capital, Abuja, Amnesty International reports more than 40 members of the Islamic Movement of Nigeria were killed last Monday during a peaceful demonstration demanding the release of their jailed leader. The Nigerian military's official Twitter account initially posted, then later deleted a tweet reading, "Please watch and make your deductions." It was accompanied by video of Trump warning soldiers should shoot migrants who throw rocks. The United Nations is warning the U.S.-supported Saudi-led assault on Yemen is contributing to the death of a young child every 10 minutes. Geert Capellari of the UN Children's Fund, known as UNICEF, warned Saturday that a Saudi assault and blockade on the port city of Hodeidah is increasing shortages of food, drinking water and medicine.
Today, every 10 minutes in Yemen, a child is dying from preventable diseases. Today in Yemen, 1.8 million children under the age of 5 are suffering from acute malnutrition. 400,000 of these children are suffering the life-threatening form of severe acute malnutrition.
The UN now says some 14 million Yemenis are on the verge of famine and 1.2 million suspected cases of cholera, over 2,400 cholera-related deaths since an outbreak began last year. The Trump administration continues to support the Saudi-led coalition with weapon sales, intelligence sharing and mid-air refueling missions for Saudi coalition bombers. The sons of the assassinated journalist Jamal Khashoggi have called on Saudi authorities to return their father's body to be buried in the Saudi city of Medina. Their appeal came as Turkish media reported Khashoggi's dismembered body parts were smuggled out of Turkey in 5 suitcases after Khashoggi was killed by a squad of Saudi hitmen inside the Saudi consulate in Istanbul on October 2nd. In Pakistan, violent protests have erupted over the acquittal last week of a Christian woman sentenced to die for the crime of blasphemy. Asia Bibi spent almost 8 years on death row until she was acquitted by Pakistan's Supreme Court Wednesday. Her lawyer has reportedly fled Pakistan in fear for his life. She was convicted of insulting Islam in 2010 after Bibi argued with a pair of Muslim women who refused to drink water from the same container as her. In Egypt, gunmen fired on a pair of buses carrying Coptic Christians Friday, killing 7 people, including 6 members of the same family, and wounding 18 others. The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the massacre in Minya province, south of Cairo. Egypt's Interior Ministry claimed Sunday its officers fought a battle with the gunmen after the assault, killing 19 of them. On Saturday, mourners at a funeral for the victims protested when a bishop thanked security forces for protecting their church. Scores of Egypt's Coptic Christians have been killed in similar attacks in recent years. In Afghanistan, the Pentagon says Utah National Guard Major Brent Taylor was killed in action Saturday after an Afghan Army commando he was helping to train turned against him. Taylor was 39 years old, had taken a 1-year leave of absence as mayor of North Ogden, Utah, to deploy to Afghanistan. His death came as the inspector general for the Pentagon's war effort reported Afghanistan's government continues to lose ground to the Taliban, with Kabul's influence reaching just over half of Afghanistan's district. Voters in the South Pacific archipelago of New Caledonia have rejected an independence bid and will remain in French territory. About 175,000 people were eligible to cast ballots in Sunday's referendum, which would have made New Caledonia the world's newest nation. Back in the United States, the Supreme Court ruled Friday that a landmark climate lawsuit brought by children and young adults can proceed in a federal court in Oregon. The 21 young activists launched their lawsuit under the Obama administration. They argue the federal government has failed to take necessary action to curtail fossil fuel emissions, violating their constitutional rights. To see our many interviews with the children, you can go to democracynow.org. A federal court has denied a bid by the Justice Department to halt a lawsuit accusing President Trump of violating the U.S. Constitution's ban on receiving bribes from foreign powers. The suit accuses Trump of violating the Foreign Emoluments Clause of the Constitution by receiving payments from foreign governments through the Trump International Hotel in Washington, D.C., and other establishments around the world. The lawsuit could force Trump to reveal financial records, including his income tax returns, which Trump has refused to make public. In New York, 26-year-old James Polite was arrested and charged with hate crimes Friday night. for vandalizing a Brooklyn synagogue and other targeted acts against the Jewish community. Polite scrawled anti-Semitic and racist messages, including "Jew better be ready" and "insert of and here" on the walls of the Union Temple Synagogue in Prospect Heights, Brooklyn, Thursday evening, prompting the cancellation of an event hosted by Broad City's Alana Glazer. I was also due to appear at the event. She was going to interview me about coverage of the midterm elections. Polite is also charged with setting fires at a number of locations Thursday night and in the early hours of Friday morning. He was apprehended after setting a fire at a Jewish school in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, on Friday. According to a New York Times profile from 2017, Polite was raised in the foster system, struggled with substance abuse and mental illness, but developed an interest in politics, leading him to volunteer for Barack Obama in 2008 and then intern for then-City Council Speaker Christine Quinn. He reportedly worked on hate crimes, sexual assault and domestic violence while in Quinn's office. To see our interview with Broad City's Alana Glazer on Friday, go to our website at democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We begin today's show in Tallahassee, Florida, where two women were shot dead at a yoga studio on Friday afternoon by a far-right extremist and self-proclaimed misogynist. 40-year-old Scott Beerley had a track record of attacking women, Black people and immigrants via online videos and songs, and had previously been investigated for harassing women and arrested at least twice, once on allegations of battery against women. In 2014, he was banned from the Florida State University campus. On Friday evening, Beerley entered a hot yoga studio in Tallahassee, reportedly posing as a customer before opening fire on the class. He shot and killed two women. Four other women were shot but survived, including one woman who was shot 9 times. Beerley also pistol-whipped a man in the rampage before turning the gun on himself. The man reportedly attempted to stop the gunman, wrestling Beerley after his gun jammed. Police say he was found dead at the yoga studio from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. The two victims of the massacre are 61-year-old Nancy Van Vessem, a medical doctor and a faculty member at Florida State University, and 21-year-old Mara Binkley. She was a student at Florida State University as well, majoring in German and journalism. Binkley had traveled to Washington, D.C. in the wake of the Parkland massacre to lobby lawmakers with Parkland survivors and their families. She was a major advocate of gun control. BuzzFeed has reported Beerley posted racist and misogynistic video screeds on a YouTube channel in 2014, where he called women sluts and whores. He also bemoaned, quote, the collective treachery of girls who had attended high school with him. Another of his 2014 videos was titled "The Rebirth of My Misogynism." Beerley had also expressed sympathy for Elliot Rodger, who killed 6 people in Isla Vista, California, in 2014 after posting a misogynistic video online vowing to take his revenge on women for sexually rejecting him. Rodger had urged other incels, or involuntary celibates, to fight back. Beerley reportedly served 2 years in the military from 2008 to 2010. Friday's attack comes in the wake of a spate of lethal gun attacks in recent weeks. Last month, a gunman entered Pittsburgh's Tree of Life Synagogue Saturday, shooting and killing 11 Jewish worshipers in what has been described as the deadliest anti-Semitic attack in American history. Just days before that, a white gunman fatally shot 2 African-Americans at a Kentucky grocery store shortly after trying and failing to enter a Black church. To talk more about the implications of Friday's attack and the murder of 2 women, we go to Washington, D.C., where we're joined by Soraya Chemale, longtime writer, feminist activist, author of the new book Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger. She's also director of the Women's Media Center Speech Project. Soraya, welcome back to Democracy Now!
Thank you, Amy.
Talk about what you understood happened on Friday afternoon. It was about 5:30, apparently, when this man walked into this yoga studio in Tallahassee, Florida.
I think it's very clear that it was a premeditated act of violence. And he walked into a yoga studio, which is a target of opportunity, like a school, for example, or a shopping mall, where there are certainly predictably more women. He set out, I think, to kill women, and that's what he did. In many of these cases, men are also hurt and killed, as in the case with Elliot Rodger. But, you know, I think he's been very clear. He documented his intent. He documented his feelings. And there is this direct connection between these communities of misogynistic and racist hate and the violence that we are seeing.
Explain the male supremacy movement.
The male supremacy movement is sort of sprawling, networked communities that believe that men are being wronged, first of all, and that they're being oppressed. And they're extremely authoritarian at their core because they're based on ideas and rules and hierarchies in which men dominate. And when men's domination is challenged, either through women achieving political power or withholding sex in the case of incels that men feel they're owed, those are challenges. And the way it becomes tessellated in the brain of some of these men is that they're actually defending themselves. I think George Lakoff years ago wrote an excellent piece about the metaphorical language of rape and showed the way men who assault women and rape and then eventually kill women see this as a way of self-defense, which we saw in Elliot Rodger's manifestos and in videos such as the one that this perpetrator had made.
And explain who incels are and what 4chan is and where you can find these kind of channels, for example, that he kept on YouTube.
So, actually, they're openly available on any of these platforms. Reddit is a thriving ground. Reddit, I think, has tried on various occasions to shut down some incel groups, but they regenerate in other forms as subreddits. 4chan, 8chan, YouTube, these are openly available expressions of misogynistic, usually misogynistic hatred that's married with racism and xenophobia. And people are free to say what they want to say, and they do. And so it's not very difficult to find this. I mean, for those of us who've been writing about it or very aware for years, this is sort of unsurprising. I think that the levels of vitriol and hatred and grossly misogynistic language and imagery that we see in these places shocks people. But I'm not sure why. I mean, this is not new. And in fact, it's sort of an extreme efflorescence of what we see in the popular culture. But we shouldn't be surprised by it anymore.
This whole definition of incel, what this means?
Well, it's a portmanteau of the words involuntary and celibate. It was actually used for the first time by a woman in Canada in 1997 or 98, I believe, to describe her own state of involuntary celibacy. But it was never meant to be what it has become, which is a completely male-dominated statement of aggrieved entitlement, usually aggrieved sexual entitlement. She herself has bemoaned this course that it's taken and has started an alternative organization that's very focused on the expression of love. What often happens is that lonely boys and men who, you know, struggle with expression, I believe, that is tied to all kinds of other issues. I write about this in the book, in that emotional regulation of men causes extreme loneliness. I mean, we talk about anger being difficult for women and detached from femininity, but anger and loneliness are thought to be part of being masculine, and it's really destructive. It's destructive to boys and men. It's destructive to the society. But they start off as potentially very lonely people and then get recruited into these environments that become more and more extreme and radicalized. So you go from a person who maybe feels hurt or lonely to a person who then has a vengeful, violent and deeply misogynistic community encouraging them to do harm, either to themselves or to other people.
According to BuzzFeed, in one video, Beerley said he resented having to subsidize, as a taxpayer, the casual sex lives of slutty girls through the Affordable Care Act's contraception provisions. In the same video, he criticized the invasion of Central American children in the U.S. I put that in quotes, invasion of, and said the migrants seeking asylum should be deported on barges. Can you talk about this intersection of anti-woman and anti-immigrant hatred?
Well, it all exists on a continuum, right? And the issue for a lot of these men in these communities is not just anti-woman, but also the idea that a white woman would willingly engage in a relationship with a man who was not white. We saw that also with Elliot Rodger, who's sort of glorified in these communities. And so we see that in these extreme forms, but in fact, we see it laundered throughout the media ecosystem, certainly on the right, where the language of our politics is infused with this fear and this denigration and disgust of people of color and of women simultaneously. And so the idea behind marrying immigrants and feeling that they are threatening and dangerous goes hand in hand with the regulation of women. Sometimes we hear the regulation or redistribution of sex used as an expression in mainstream media, but what we're really talking about is the redistribution of women. And eliding those two things is really unhelpful. And so we see white supremacist movements, which are focused on pushing back immigrants in a sort of toxic border patrol mentality of jailing dark black people in the country as a way of containing them. And we see that same language of containment and disgust in the idea that we should, you know, lock her up for Hillary Clinton or continue to control women's reproduction as a function of a right of men, as entitlement of men to do this.
And he served in the military, Soraya.
Well, I mean, I think if you find comfort in rules and regulations and hierarchy and status, if that is your mindset, then you are also inclined, accordingly, to punish the people who break those rules and to feel aggrieved if you are among those who are not benefiting from those rules. And so in the incel community, you can see the language infused with those ideas, with the idea that there are these hierarchies of men and that women are lying, manipulative social climbers who will degrade you and deny you the right to sex, in the case of incels, because they want to scale the ladder and reward men who deserve it in other ways.
You know, what about the climate now? I mean, just Friday afternoon, I was watching President Obama give a speech in Tallahassee, right? He was there to support Andrew Gillum and Senator Nelson. This is in Tallahassee. It wasn't hours later before Beerley went into this Tallahassee yoga studio. And Trump also came to Florida this weekend. In the past week, Trump revving up his anti-immigrant rhetoric, talking about the invaders coming, something that was cited by Bowers, the man who shot up the Jewish synagogue in Pittsburgh. And President Trump didn't let up. He doubled down on using those words. When the bomb letters are sent to Obama and sent to George Soros, he continues to attack Soros, Obama, and with that kind of revving up of anger against Obama, Obama in Tallahassee that day, your thoughts?
Well, I mean, I think it's very clear that he uses this rhetoric of violence and confrontation, and his language is deeply dehumanizing. It's dehumanizing to people of color, to immigrants, to women. And, you know, the dehumanizing language is the first step to the humiliation, degradation, and then eventually violence that we see against people. There's no disconnecting the language and rhetoric that's being used by the president from the violence that we're seeing, the high emotional tone of our political life. And so, you know, I think to suggest, as is often the case from the White House, that there's no responsibility or no connection between the words and the actions that we're seeing is misleading, to say the least.
Well, Soraya Chomali, I want to thank you for being with us. Longtime writer, feminist activist, has a new book out. It's called Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger. She's also director of the Women's Media Center Speech Project. And I just want to end with the words of the rabbi in Pittsburgh, who greeted President Trump, though many felt he should not go to Pittsburgh last week after the shooting, in a short speech sermon on Saturday. Rabbi Jeffrey Myers blamed politicians for a rise in hateful rhetoric, saying it led to the massacre at a synagogue last week in which 11 Jews were slain worshiping, considered the worst anti-Semitic attack on U.S. soil in history. Myers said that he delivered the message personally to President Trump and First Lady Melania when they visited the synagogue. He said, I said to him, Mr. President, hate speech leads to hateful actions. Hate speech leads to what happened in my sanctuary, where seven of my congregants were slaughtered. I witnessed it with my eyes. This is Democracy Now! We'll be back with Noam Chomsky in a minute. Choose, the video and song by Anne-Marie Kay. This is Democracy Now! I'm Mimi Goodman. With the U.S. midterm elections a day away, we continue our conversation with world-renowned linguist, dissident, author Noam Chomsky. Democracy Now!'s Nermeen Sheikh and I interviewed him from Tucson, Arizona, where he now teaches at the University of Arizona. Noam Chomsky is also Institute Professor Emeritus at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he's taught for more than 50 years. During part one of the conversation that we played on Friday, Noam Chomsky talked about what's at stake in tomorrow's midterm elections.
So is it the most gravest moment in my life? Yes, but also in all of human history. And things like the election will have an impact on this.
During our conversation on Thursday, I asked Professor Chomsky to outline some of the issues he thinks should be followed most closely.
What are the domestic policies of the Trump administration? A very straightforward, lavish gifts on the rich, powerful corporate sector, and try to undermine and destroy anything that might be of benefit to the general population. That's quite explicitly what's happening before our eyes. So take the a legislative achievement that the Republican Party is most proud of, their tax bill. As economist Joseph Stiglitz described it, the donor relief plan of 2017. It's an enormous gift to wealth, corporate power, including real estate interests, incidentally. Enormous gift, frankly. And it has the secondary advantage, as the Republican leadership was quick to point out, it has the advantage of creating a huge deficit, which can be used to as a pretext for getting rid of social spending. U.S. social spending is already very meager by world standards. We're down at the bottom of the OECD, the 30 rich countries, along with Greece and Turkey and social benefit spendings. But there's something there, so let's get rid of it. let's undermine Medicaid, which goes to the undeserving poor. Let's undermine Social Security, which working people just rely on for survival, all because we have to lavish gifts on the super rich and ensure that the corporations have profits bulging out of their ears. The claim of the pretext for the tax scam was that it was going to sharply increase investment. That was pretty outlandish to start with. Corporations already have just overflowing with profits and wealth, and predictably did nothing of the sort. Those are the domestic programs. Then come all of these international horrors that we're talking about. I don't want to suggest that the mainstream Democrats are all that better in these respects, somewhat. And there is a progressive wave among the sectors of the Democratic Party that could lead in a much more constructive direction. But the midterms next week are going to have a critical impact on how the country goes, and given the enormous power and wealth of this country, what happens to the world.
And on that issue, you have been extremely critical of Democrats. But with this whole discussion of whether the House will turn Democrat and possibly the Senate, do you think it matters?
I think it matters. Yes, we have every reason to be critical of the Democrats. These policies of the last generation, the neoliberal policies that have led to these conditions we've been talking about, the so-called New Democrats, the Clinton Democrats, have been right at the forefront. Say, deregulation of financial institutions, one of Clinton's great achievements, which led directly to the financial crisis. So along with one of the factors that led to it, his attack on the welfare program. Lots that we can blame them for. In fact, I should say that some of the things that Trump has done, which merit praise, are bitterly attacked by the Democrats and by the Republican hawks, in particular with regard to Korea. In April, last April, the two Koreas, North and South, issued a historic declaration, Panmunjom Declaration, in which they laid out for the first time fairly detailed plans, moves towards reduction of tension, reconciliation, reduction of weaponry, denuclearization, very sensible, detailed plans. And they virtually pleaded with the outside world, meaning the United States, not to interfere. What they said is the two Koreas will proceed with these plans on their own accord, crucially. In other words, let us do it. Trump, to his credit, has not interfered. The Singapore summit, for which he was lambasted, was one of his one of his very few admirable achievements. He not only did not intervene, but he even withdrew what he correctly described as provocative U.S. South Korean military operations. Well, all of that should be supported. I don't know what his reasons were, maybe ridiculous reasons, but doesn't matter. These are moves that should be supported. Those are the things for which he's being bitterly attacked. So it's not an entirely, sort of a clear issue. Nevertheless, overwhelmingly, the Republican Party is simply a major threat to not only to the country, but to human survival. I've said in the past that I think they're the most dangerous organization in human history on the issue of climate change alone. And I think that's worth repeating.
World-renowned linguist, dissident, and author Noam Chomsky will return to our conversation with him in a minute to talk about the threats of nuclear war and climate change. But tune in Tuesday night for Democracy Now!'s live coverage of the midterm elections. We're teaming up with The Intercept for this special broadcast from 7 p.m. Eastern time to 1 in the morning. Check your local listings or simply go to democracynow.org. Back with Noam Chomsky in a minute.
Words are flowing out like endless rain into a paper cup. They slither while they pass, they slip away across the universe. Pools of sorrow, waves of joy are drifting through my open mind, possessing and caressing me.
Across the Universe by Fiona Apple. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh as we continue our conversation with the world-renowned linguist and dissident Noam Chomsky. We interviewed him Thursday in Tucson, Arizona, where he now teaches at the University of Arizona. I asked him to respond to President Trump's recent decision to pull out of the INF, the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, that landmark nuclear arms pact signed in 1987 by President Ronald Reagan and Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev.
Well, the INF Treaty was a very important development. You may recall that in that period, in the early and mid-80s, this has to do with short-range nuclear missiles. They were being installed in Western Europe, Pershing II missiles in Western Europe, which had a few minutes flight time to Moscow. If you think what that means, the Russian detection systems are, first of all, far more primitive than ours, but even sophisticated. If they had had sophisticated detection systems, it would have given them barely a few minutes warning before a possible heavy nuclear strike, even a decapitation strike against Moscow. And the Russians were doing the same. They were building short-term missiles aimed at Western Europe. Notice, not at the United States. This was internal to Europe, short-range missiles. Well, the 1987 INF Treaty ended that extreme peril. Sharply reduced it. The missiles were reduced and so on. It was an important step forward. Breaking the treaty reinstates that system. Now, there's an obvious way to deal with the problem. Namely, it's called, it's kind of a bad word. Maybe I ought to spell it. It's called diplomacy. There have been, the way to deal with the problem is quite straightforward. Do what has not been done as yet. Have technical experts from both sides and neutral ones investigate the claims that are being made by both sides and determine if they're valid, and to the extent that there are, negotiate a way to overcome these violations of the treaty, and then enforce the treaty even further, carry it further. We should be moving towards eliminating nuclear weapons. Remember that the New START Treaty is coming up for renewal. That's a very important one. START has led to the sharp reduction of nuclear weapons, by no means anywhere near far enough, but nevertheless quite significant. We should also recall that Trump's pulling out of the INF Treaty has a precursor, namely the Nuclear Posture Review of the Trump administration, which already called for developing new weapons, tactical nuclear weapons, which themselves greatly increase the threat of a possible war. A target of these missiles can't know whether they're conventional or nuclear, or whether they're short range or much more powerful missiles. You have a few minutes warming time to make these decisions. You look over the history of the nuclear age, and it is practically miraculous that we've survived this far. I mean, there's been case after case where we came, both sides came very close to making a decision to launch nuclear weapons, which means basically terminating human civilization. And miracles like that can't go on forever. And enhancing the threat is just beyond insanity. Ending the INF Treaty not only opens the door for the United States and Russia to develop more dangerous, lethal weapons, but of course for others to join in as well, greatly increasing the hazard to all of us. And there are diplomatic options that have not been pursued, and they are the ones that should be uppermost, not vastly endangering ourselves and everyone else. Trump also brought up the fact that China's not a partner to the INF. Yeah, they're not. Well, the way to, and it's because of their particular geostrategic position and their defensive posture in Eastern Eurasia. So the way to deal with that problem is to bring them into the treaty, not to break the treaty and greatly increase the danger to the world. We should bear in mind that the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists, which has established since 1947, beginning of the nuclear age, it's established a doomsday clock where the minute hand is a certain distance from midnight. Midnight means goodbye, termination of all of us. At the beginning, 1947, it was 7 minutes to midnight. It's oscillated up and back since. Last January, after a year of the Trump administration, it moved to 2 minutes to midnight. That's the closest it's been to terminal disaster ever, with one exception, 1953. The United States, then the Soviet Union, exploded thermonuclear weapons, demonstrating that in our ingenuity, we had devised the means to destroy everything. At that point, the clock did move to 2 minutes to midnight. Hasn't gone that close to disaster since, but it did last January. And now it's worse. The Nuclear Posture Review, the revelation since that time that the U.S. actually has developed a first strike potential, which could eliminate any deterrent to a first strike. Then Trump's Nuclear Posture Review, which calls for extending the nuclear threat. And now this latest step. This is a march to disaster, which is only paralleled by the moves of the administration to race towards the cliff of environmental destruction with eyes open. They know exactly what they're doing. Trump himself is a firm believer in global warming, the others as well. But just in order to fill a couple of overstuffed pockets with more dollars, they're willing to threaten the existence of organized human life. There's just no words to describe these two drives to destruction in parallel, or in fact to describe the fact that they're barely discussed in the electoral season. These are the two most important issues.
Noam, we want to turn to an issue that you have written about, that so many are so deeply concerned about, that hardly gets any play in this country, even in this critical midterm election. It's the issue of climate change. Noam Chomsky, a new study has found that the world has massively underestimated the amount of heat absorbed by our oceans. The paper published in the journal Nature has concluded that for the past quarter of a century, about 150 times the amount of energy used to generate electricity globally has been deposited into the seas, 60% more than previous estimates.
This comes days after leading meteorologist Eric Holthaus issued a dire warning following Jair Bolsonaro's election win in Brazil. He tweeted, quote, "This is worth repeating over and over. The most horrific thing Brazil's new president, Jair Bolsonaro, has planned is privatization of the Amazon rainforest. With just 12 years remaining to remake the global economy and prevent catastrophic climate change, this is planetary suicide," he wrote. Meanwhile, in a report issued earlier this week, the World Wildlife Fund found that human beings have wiped out 60% of all mammals, birds, fish, and reptiles on Earth since 1970. This is WWF Executive Director of Science and Conservation, Mike Barrett.
What's absolutely clear at the moment, looking at the declines of nature that we're currently seeing, is that the planet does need to be put on life support. And frankly, the solutions we're coming up with at the moment are merely sticking plasters. So this is now at the point where, as people, we've got to take a choice. Are we going to let this continue? Are we going to do something about it? Globally, at the moment, we are completely failing to tackle the loss of nature on the planet. And that's got to stop now.
So that's Mike Barrett of the World Wildlife Fund. Noam, you are deeply concerned about this issue, and of course, you're not alone. Climate change, the issue of climate change.
We can add to the list of your dire warnings, as if it weren't horrendous enough, a few more examples. A couple of weeks ago, the IPCC, the International Group of Scientists Monitoring Climate Change, came out with a very ominous report. Warning that the world has maybe a decade or two to basically end its reliance on fossil fuels if we're to have any hope of controlling global warming below the level of utter disaster. And that, incidentally, is a conservative estimate. It's a consensus view. There are repeatedly over the years, it has been shown that the IPCC analyses are much less alarmist than they should be. Now comes this report in Nature that you mentioned a couple of days ago, which shows that there has been a serious underestimate of the warming of the oceans. And they conclude that if these results hold up, the so-called carbon budget, the amount of carbon that we can spew into the atmosphere and still have a survivable environment, has to be reduced by about 25%. That's over and above the IPCC report. And the opening up of the Amazon to further exploitation will be another serious blow at the prospects of survival of organized human society. I should, at the same time, the Trump administration right now is opening up new areas of the West for fracking, for increasing the use of fossil fuels. You've probably seen, maybe discussed, the one of the most amazing documents I have ever seen. The Trump Department of Highway Standards, whatever it's called, just issued a long report, 100-page report, urging that all regulations on automotive emissions should be ended. And they had a very logical argument. They said if we extrapolate current trends, by the end of the century, the climate will have warmed several degrees centigrade, meaning a huge rise in sea level, which they underestimate. So basically, we're going over the cliff anyway, and automotive emissions don't really add much to this, so there's no point cutting them back. The assumption of the department is that everyone in the world is as criminally insane as we are and isn't going to do anything about it. And since on that assumption, yeah, let's just rob while the planet burns, putting Nero into the shade. He only fiddled while Rome burned. I can't think of anything like this in human history. You just can't find words to describe it. And it's, I mean, at the peak of the monstrosity is, in fact, the Trump administration. And we should recall that Trump himself, as I mentioned, is a firm believer in global warming. Recently, he applied to the government of Ireland for permission to build a huge wall, one of his famous walls, this one to protect a golf course of his in Ireland, which, as his plea indicates, is threatened by sea level rise as a result of global warming. You take a look at the big banks, you know, J.P. Morgan Chase and the others. They're increasing their investments in fossil fuel development. The energy corporations are working all over the world to try to find new resources to destroy the environment. The media are focusing on real outrages, like the ludicrous military preparation for this wave of mothers and children planning to invade us and destroy us. You know, they're concentrating on that. But take a look at their coverage of these things. So there was a big report, long front page report in the New York Times a couple of days ago about the opening up of the West to further fossil fuel extraction, discussed everything you can think of, did mention some of the negative consequences, like it might harm water resources, it might make things harder for ranchers. Not one phrase, in this long report on the effect on the environment in the political campaign going on. All kinds of issues are not discussed, but not the two existential threats that the human beings face, threats that have never arisen in human history. We have to make decisions now which will literally determine whether organized human life can survive in any decent form. You can just imagine what the world would be like if the sea level rises, say, 10 or 20 feet or even higher, which is within the range, easily within the range of predictions. I mean, the consequences are unimaginable, but it's as if we're kind of like the proverbial lemmings, just happily marching off the cliff, led by leaders who understand very well what they're doing, but are so dedicated to enriching themselves and their friends in the near future that it simply doesn't matter what happens to the human species. There's nothing like this in all of human history. There have been plenty of monsters in the past, plenty of them, but you can't find one who was dedicated with passion to destroying the prospects for organized human life. Hitler was horrible enough, but not that.
World-renowned linguist, dissident, author Noam Chomsky. You can visit our website for part one of the interview, where Chomsky talks about U.S. foreign policy in Latin America, the migrant caravan, the crisis in Gaza, and the white supremacist attack on the Pittsburgh synagogue. Tune in Tuesday night for Democracy Now!'s live coverage of the midterm elections. We're teaming up with The Intercept for a special broadcast from 7 p.m. Eastern to 1 in the morning. You can check your local listings or go to democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Is also accepting applications for for new paid internships. Go to our website for that information. Democracy Now! Is produced by Mike Burke, Dina Gusdorf, Noreen Sheikh, Carla Wells, Tammy Warrenoff, Sam Alcock, John Hamilton, Robbie Karen, I'm Amy Goodman.